Ready to rock. Give me a Y if you're ready to rock. Hello, Larians. I'm Dale Pinkert. I'm your anchor here at FX Street. Euro dollar came out of the hole. I want to acknowledge Sirik for his analysis for about 3 days showing the bullish white swan in Euro, a harmonic pattern that Sirik has been showing day after day this week, finally manifesting to the upside. And I'd also like to acknowledge Ricardo, who yesterday we got to that 77 objective in Euro pound. And now looks like we could get Ricardo's scenario for a failing rally, possibly a right shoulder up around 78 and a half. So here's our neckline. So either a descending triangle or a right shoulder as the euro, some short covering takes the euro back up. And then next target is going to be down around 74 and a half, which coincidentally was the breakout of the weekly head and shoulders bottom. So that's where I think we're going. So let's hope that the NFP, which the market's looking for a good number, perhaps doesn't come in as strong as expected. We get the dollar sell-off from this 98.50 level, and it provides us with a shorting opportunity in euro pound to ride it back down towards 75 to 74. Those are my calls. The next one is yours. We have an outstanding guest today. One of my favorite people to interview is Ashraf Laidi is with us today. What's great about Ashraf is that he's very insightful, compelling insights and views on the markets, and a great sense of humor. So a unique combo. Ashraf Laidi, Adel Laidi will be with us for our interview today. So those are my calls, Larians. The next ones are yours. Who's in the house today? Ziggy, great tweet today. Ron the Dutch, how have you been, buddy? Sirik, great call on the bullish white swan. Pipper, how are you? Morning, Grays. Abel, I love you, buddy. How are you? Mauricio is my wingman today. It's great. It's like the old days. Mauricio's here, probably giving Adinda a day off. So I look at Mauricio, he's kind of like Colonel Parker, who discovered Elvis Presley. So Mauricio discovered me on FX Street. He's my Colonel Parker. Believed in what we could do here together on FX Street, develop a social trading community, which is what we've done. And I'm Elvis. Okay, guys, you know, I'm Elvis in my own mind. I'm Elvis in my own mind. Love me, Larians. Love me true. Please don't leave the room. We'll show charts and real good trades. Make your accounts go boom. So love me, Larians. Love me, Larians. Love me true. All our dreams fulfilled. 'Cause oh my Larians will do well, and I thank you, you, all of you, Ricardo, Alien, Sirik, Sinatra, everybody, and I thank you too. Let's go to work. So I'm not looking to do much today in front of the NFP, guys. you know, break out your 15-minute charts like Ricardo did yesterday if you want to trade. But don't hold a position into the NFP tomorrow. That's not trading. That's roulette. So let's see some looks. Let's see what we got here. Let's see what we got going here, guys. Colonel Parker got, wow, he had a good deal. All right, we have a screenshot from Mystic. He thinks we'll see 110. I concur. Yeah, 110 looks viable to me too. Mystic, thanks for your look. Thank you, Mystic. Hi, Sinatra. Midas. Yeah, got to 41, no pullback. Yeah, how are you, Midas? Yeah, I'm not either. What do you got, Sirik? A white swan? Wow. Kind of unusual, they both being a white swan. So if this is true in Canada, be careful if you're long crude. Because if we get this move that Sirik's looking for in USD CAD, I think it's going to imply weaker energy prices. I still thought we could go to 37, 38. Maybe we get one pullback before that manifests. Thank you, Sirik. Hi, Dion. No, I just want to be chairman of the Fed or secretary of the Treasury, Ron. Actually, I'd settle for a cable TV network show. I'd settle for just being on television so I could make fun of the president. So Midas is looking for 1325. How are you, Dion? Mike's looking for 1325 back down here in the end. Maybe even a little deeper, a little ABC to 13, Midas. And then we go again. So this gives us a pullback in crude, a pullback in the S&Ps, and a pullback in the dollar. Just my extremely accurate and humble opinion of what the markets can do. Welcome back, Gary. How are you? Jason, Carol, welcome back. Horace, welcome to LAR. Ed Z, Tosin, Numbers, JJ, Richard Perry, Gold, Silver, Phil, if you guys are sticking around after your show. Tosin's getting long on a pullback. He's a gunslinger. SW, how are you? Fame, is my chair on the way? Roland, FX Street Administrator, Alexandros, how are you? Forex Pipper, double A is a new handle. Everyone welcome, double A, unlike triple A, the auto club. Welcome, double A. Ziggy, great tweet. Here's Ziggy's tweet for the day. Great tweet. Here's Ziggy's tweet. BW, welcome back. Jake, how have you been? Yeah, that's me. That's me, SW. I'm a wannabe. I prefer to say that I already am a B. I'm a B. I'm doing it, buddy. How about you? I help people every day, Every day I help people. Like Mother Teresa said, although I'm not on television, I do little things with great love. And I believe that, you know, I'm getting a vibe from you, SW, but I would bet $1 million that Lara's helped you, even you. What do you think? Has Lara been a benefit and added value to your trading experience at FX Street? Maybe you're going through a drawdown. How you doing, Sinatra? Yeah, that was a good call. Good call, Frank. I would just like to reach more people. That's my goal. I want to help more people. So the larger the bandwidth I have, the more people I can help. That's the way I see it. So here's Sinatra's look. Give me why if Lara's helped you, if I've helped you, if Mauricio has helped you, being part of this community, small though it may be, great in its works. Yeah, the bullish divergence, nice, Sinatra. Someone asked me, how are you today, Dale? I'm brilliant as a diamond. You better put on your shades. Too soon to say. Okay. Well, you let me know. I'll wire a refund out to you. Anytime you want a refund, SW, let me know. So, looking forward to talking to Ashraf. You just said it's too soon for you to say that Lara's added value. I think someone could come in here for a week. And if they just sit back and pay attention to all the great analysis that takes place here 2 hours a day, within a week would know that there's added value to their trading here. If you guys agree, give me a why. Did everyone know here within a week that this added value to your trading experience at FX Street? Give me a why if it did. It's too soon for SW to say. He's been here a month. Like it would cost him something. Yeah, there you go. There's a brother. You know, guys, people ask me this. They go, Dale, why do you retweet other people's work? On Twitter, say, I think so-and-so is a great follow. Retweet charts from people, whether I agree with the scenario or not, whether or not they have 5 Twitter followers or 50,000 Twitter followers. And people ask me, Dale, why do you do that? And I say, what's the cost of saying thank you, validating, and lifting up, the lifting up of others? What does that cost you? Just a kind word, a retweet? What's the cost of lifting up others? That's what I say. And that's my mission. It used to be about only lifting myself up. Now it's about lifting up others, because that's a mission greater than myself. And I plan to continue on this mission as long as I'm breathing in and out above ground. Okay, that's the end of my lecture. Let's face it, I'm an emotional being. Yeah, the Swiss has been leading. Good observation. Like a day in advance or so. Yeah. Good insight, sir. He's saying that the Swiss has given us tells. Before the euro moves, the Swiss is leading the way, Mihail. Yeah. Mystic likes to use less leverage. That's okay. It's good to be new. Celebrate your newness. So when you're new, it's a great time. Okay, Midas is short. The Swiss and took a GU short here. I agree. If we get the bounce in euro pound, pound should be a pullback. Yeah. Good hunting on that, Midas. So, Mihail, what's great about being new is that if you develop good habits early, kind of like that guy that we had on yesterday and Mull, he's a young guy, but he developed great habits yesterday during his interview. I loved his story that to be accountable to himself, he found someone he really didn't care for and had to mail him $50 every time he was wrong in the market. And he hated sending that guy that 50 bucks so much that he worked at it so that he wouldn't have to do it as often. I thought that was a very interesting story about accountability that we got from Anmol Singh yesterday. What a sharp young man he is. Okay, I'm out of energy now. Hello, Ibby. Zurich, do you want to explain why? I see a new handle. Jasaja is here. And welcome, Jasaja. I think I misspelled it. Ed Z, how you doing? Nice to meet you. As you can see, what we doing here. Hasten Moore is here. What we do in here is we share our ideas through pictures, through screenshots. So I suggest it's a very safe environment to share your views. No one's going to get on you. If it doesn't work out, we're all captains of our own ship. Everyone here pulls for each other. Almost everybody. If I find that people aren't, they're out of here. No one roots for others to fail, to rationalize their own failures. So everyone welcome Hassan to good one, Zig. Yeah, me too, Jay. Me too, brother. Thanks for mentoring Mihail Sirik. Thank you, Sirik, for all the great contributions you make to our community. Ziggy, thank you for all your great contributions. FX Praise, always happy to see your handle in here. Jax, how are you, buddy? Thank you for your contributions. Forex Stop Hunter, thank you for yours. Sinatra, thank you for yours. Tosin, thank you for yours. Numbers, you're putting out some ideas. Please get some screenshot software. Ron, always great to see your handle with us. You're living the dream. SW, thank you for your contributions. Alexandros, thank you for all of your contributions. Forex Pipper, thank you. Midas, so great to have you back with us. Dion, get some screenshot software, start sharing some charts. Gary, welcome. BW, get some screenshot software and start sharing your work. FX Goldie's in the house, he's my brother. FX Goldie, thank you for all your contributions that you make to our community. Of course, it goes without saying, Ricardo and Alien and all the other guys that aren't here right now that make LAR great. What are you thinking in here, Goldie? I'm glad you're enjoying. Use max leverage before the NFP. Load up the max before the NFP. Use max leverage before the NFP. And your account will be history. Hold it. There. So use max leverage before the NFP. I hope you get it right. Otherwise, your account will be history. Just kidding, guys. You like this note? How about this? Jax, vibrato. How's that, man? I could bend them and make it sing. That song makes, had to make you cry at least once today, buddy. Everyone doing all right? We have Ashraf here in a little over a half hour. Looking forward to talking to my trading warrior brother, Ashraf Laidi. You're crying harder. Okay. Carol, how are you? Hope you're enjoying your time here with us in our community. Double A's, same to you. So pretty quiet, not unexpected in front of the NFP. NFP is becoming more and more critical to the Fed confusion, right? Moves you out of the room. I bet it moves you right out of the room, right out of earshot. So we're coming up on a 3-year anniversary of Mauricio. 3 more months and we'll be celebrating our 3rd year of LAR. How about that? Who thought it would last 3 years? Yeah. In this industry, you have staying power if you last 3 months. So 3rd year of LAR. It better, maybe it goes on the NFP. Here's the crude. Crude's rolling over a little. I don't know. Thank you, Praise. FX Praise has a look for us in the Kiwi. Well, very bullish look. So this ties in with stronger commodities, stronger milk prices. There's a real bullish look from FX Praise. Nice. Nice to see your work. Thanks for sharing, FX Praise. Yeah, you know, the Aussie's already gotten up to this point and broken out. So that's a big trade. You're looking at the measured move. We took out the downtrend. Maybe we fail from resistance one more time, get a pullback, and then blow out, break out over an ascending triangle. Kind of looks like an ascending triangle to me, FX Praise. Excellent look. Everyone thank FX Praise for that roadmap for a bullish outcome in the Kiwi. FX Praise donates her a portion of her profits to charity. She sows good seeds. Thank you, Praise. What a great handle. Everyone thank FX Praise. Nice look. Everyone doing okay? More people need to thank FX Praise than just Sirik and Goldie and me. I thought that was a great look. There we go. So I praise your look, FX Praise. I praise that view. Everyone doing all right? Kind of a quiet day. So really looking forward to having an opportunity to short Euro Pound. Can't rule out another blast to the upside for another drive, but I'd be looking for fib retraces here. $78.40 to $78.80. Yeah. That's why Aussie yen still has some upside to 86, right, sir? Although it may pause here. Zurich, you call a lot of things correctly. So I'm never surprised that the outcomes that you're forecasting manifest. It just doesn't surprise me anymore. Like a lot of guys in here, a lot of traders in here. Thank you, sir. That was a great call. Like usual. Just another great call by Sirik. My platform is slow. Okay, so what we could have here, Dion, is this is A, this is B, and this is C down to 113, and this will be kind of the line in the sand for a continuation move. I think 113. Midas is looking for 1330, isn't that correct, brother? I think you said a retest of these lows here. Your demand zone. And with that, I'm going to take a quick break. Thank you, everyone, for your contributions and for listening to my tirades today. I'll be back in 5. Love you, Larians. See you in 5 minutes, taking a quick break. I'll let my wingman know. Okay. I'm back. Everyone doing okay? Dion's getting his action in the US dollar yen. Ashraf should be here in about less than a half hour. Everyone doing okay? Sorry, I'm eating. S&P is lower. Little cheers higher. No, that I'm not shorting it. I'm not doing anything till tomorrow, but Midas is short the pump. In what, the crude oil, Tolson? In the crude? Okay, Alexander showed this triangle yesterday. It's breaking out. Weak dollar, softer stock market, gold getting ready to run. Sorry I'm eating, guys. I have low blood sugar. Nice look. Thank you, Tolson. I agree. So, has everyone heard about the tragedy? I believe the guy's name was Audrey McClendon. He was a pioneer in the natural gas industry in the U.S. He was indicted and then drove into a wall yesterday. Anyone aware of that news that happened yesterday? You know, his dream was for cars to go to natural gas, buses, trucks, nat gas. He discovered all the different fields that made the U.S. A huge natural gas and oil producer. Yeah. Yeah, he didn't live to see his dream of natural gas being the transition fuel between green energy, kind of a transition fuel, cleaner fuel. T-Boone Pickens, really? Yeah, well, that's what people are asking. No, He was indicted the day before, so you can surmise whatever. You have nat gas trucks? Where, Goldie? Are you in Argentina too? Yeah. But anyway, here's a natural gas ETF that I'm underwater on. So, you know, I'm not, everyone knows I never claim to be like the perfect trader or anything. I don't have any oil exposure right now, but I am scaling in. Oh, you're in the U.S.? Okay. They need to use it on the buses. Anyway, this is a natural gas ETF, symbols UGAZ. I'm underwater on. I bought more this morning. As you can tell, I'm underwater. Really? Okay. So the symbol is UGAZ. Okay. Oh, you're in Chicago? Goldie, I didn't know you were in Chicago. Doug, you own that too? What did you pay? I paid 110, I paid 85, and I bought more today at 68. I have about four or five grand into it. Maybe not when you're leveraged, but I've been doing it successfully for a year now, Grace. I'm up over 100% in my ETF trading over the last year. I would never recommend it unless you use real reduced leverage. But sometimes, I don't know, I don't completely agree with that adage. Because that's assuming you're always going to hit something on the button. Sometimes if you're early, it gives you a chance to build a position. I'm not saying that the hits won't be bigger, but you're also not shaken out and right the market, wrong the trade. But I don't, 150? Wow. Yeah, scaling in. So actually it's worked to my benefit to be early in the last 18 months. You know, I was long VIX instruments into the big crack we had in the Dow and S&Ps early this year. I was early. In fact, that's my shortcoming, getting in and out early. Yeah. So there's another counter argument. There's another counter argument to never losing, never adding to a losing position. Anyway, I just wanted to say that Audrey's gone. He had a dream. And I've just seen real ironic things happen. Real ironic things happen. You know, here's a guy who turned U.S. I move up, probably smarter, Doug. What's your upside target? I'm looking for $4, 350 to four. Anyway, the universe has a strange way of having market turns on tragedies or peaking on like George Bush, mission accomplished, you know, that kind of stuff. Anyway, just an idea I wanted to share with you guys. Another guy who's investing heavily into natural gas is Sam Zell. Sam Zell's a famous real estate guy, commercial real estate guy. And Zell, okay, Tosin. And Zelle liquidated a lot of his real estate holdings last year. 65 to 42. Okay. Thank you, Midas. Oh, Norm will be here tomorrow. Norm will be here in the opening hour tomorrow. And we will be starting an hour early. Yeah, it is. You're right, Doug. It's like buying an option that doesn't expire. You're right. So it's not going to expire. I know you do. So Norm will be here tomorrow. We're starting an hour early with the NFP coverage. I'm assuming Val, Yohei, Mauricio, and myself will be open an hour early, covering the NFP live tomorrow. Hang out with us. Okay, Goldie. They've already done that. They could do it again. You're right. Oh, Adam's going to be with us too. Thank you, Mystic. Thanks for taking the initiative. I'd love to interview Chris. I've never interviewed him before. Adam will be with us tomorrow. So anyone else wants to take the initiative like Mystic did, if there's an analyst or trader that you'd like to bring into LAR, you could be my ambassador and reach out to them in my behalf, in LAR's behalf. So Mystic took the initiative to get a hold of Chris. You guys have the same, you can do the same thing if there's someone you really would like to bring into LAR that maybe I don't know of. I think I've interviewed about 300 people in the last few years. Any idea, Mauricio, how many guests we've had in LAR in the last, since we began? One of my Colonel Parker discoveries was Giuseppe Bazile. I know that Giuseppe has a very loyal following. 700, wow. It's a lot of blabbing, buddy. And Giuseppe is now doing the Tokyo Open, sharing his program trading footprints for levels for everyone. He's doing a great job. We already know Yohei's doing a great job with the London Open. Everyone congratulate Mauricio for putting together almost a 24-hour YouTube channel 5 days a week for great content for traders. How about a kudos to Mauricio, which expanded from LAR to making it even more coverage, great coverage, excellent content. Nice call on the end, Dion. Most of them I've found on Twitter. And like I said, I like to give opportunities to people that aren't as well known. Ashraf's very well known. But I'll bring in people that aren't well known. Midas is joining me on it here. Okay, buddy. Makes me feel better about about my 110 buys and my 86 cent buys. This is my third entry. I usually don't go more than three entries, but if it gets down to your monthly demand level, I'll add again. So I have a great time doing this. You guys have a great time doing this too? Give me a why if you have a great time doing this with me every day. I may physically feel tired, but you know, I could still get it together and get charged up for a couple hours every day. Later on during the day, you'll see me like a vegetable on the couch because I do expend a lot of energy doing this, and I do other things besides this. And I'm telling you guys, by 1 o'clock Pacific time, Forex Stop Hunter is stopped out on the couch, flipping channels, having a beer around 3 in the afternoon, maybe some bean dip, falling asleep at 6 p.m., 7 p.m., falling asleep, waking up at midnight, going back to sleep. And it's not just because I have an enlarged prostate. Anyone else have an enlarged prostate in here? Give me a why. How many guys in here have to get up and go to the bathroom more than once a night? You like that lifestyle, Goldie? Where do you live in Chicago, bro? Where do you live in Chicago? Yeah, I'll take Rusty, old Rusty, us two old gray-haired men. We'll go for a little short walk. That's also part of it. I hardly get out, guys, to sing karaoke anymore. All my singing buddies, girls and guys that I sing with, they think I passed on to the afterlife. I can hardly get out there on Tuesday night anymore. It's been months. Yeah, what do you think, Zurich? Tell me it's a bullish white swan. Give me a harmonic on natural gas. Go on, buddy. Yeah. Okay, I know Libertyville. Oh, you're at University of Illinois. Okay. I've been to Champaign. I had some fun weekends there, Goldie. I actually went to college in DeKalb, but we'd go down to Champaign. Find one. And Libertyville, let me tell you about Libertyville. All right, Goldie? So I went to college at NIU. Nice work, Tozen. And in the one summer, I was offered a chance to work construction. Okay. I was offered a job to work construction. I grew up in Skokie. And me and a buddy of mine from high school, we were laborers, would drive out to Libertyville every day to work on this apartment complex. And one day the foreman found me asleep in one of the apartments and fired me on the spot. I don't blame him. And I had to hitchhike home. But the lesson was for me at 18, 19 years old is I better find a way to make a living using my brain, because I knew I wasn't going to be a construction worker after that. Oh, Doug, you're in Charleston. Okay, wow. Yeah. So that's my story about Libertyville. Also, I believe that's where I got my driver's license. We had to go to Libertyville to get my driver's license. But I learned early at 19 that I was going to have to make a living using my brain rather than my body. Although in my 20s, people said I looked a lot like Richard Gere in American Gigolo. In my 20s, people said I looked like Richard Gere in American Gigolo. Look at, you guys could all get together. You guys can all get together. Okay, SW. Yeah. No, no, not Johnny Cash. From the front, man. Let's see, the last comparison, I used to get Rod Stewart, which I never got, Rod Stewart. Oh, here's one you like, Jax. Leslie Nielsen. Someone once said to me, you look like Leslie Nielsen, the comedian who recently passed away. That wasn't that flattering. From the front, since I don't have a butt, I have a flat butt, Jax. ISM up. Ashraf should be with us shortly. Stick around for Ashraf. What do you mean dying? You're not dying. L'chaim, Mahal. L'chaim. To life. To life. To life. L'chaim. L'chaim, l'chaim. To life. Okay. Was I at the eye doctor waiting room because I have eye disease? San Diego. North County, around Carlsbad. Carlsbad. You're a shooter, Dion. Nice work, Midas, and thank you for your transparency. That's a good day, better than a sharp stick in the eye. Great to have you back. Who remembers Midas from the beginning? Abel does. Mauricio does. You forgot your SL. They have medical marijuana up there? Any medical marijuana up there in coal country? Yeah, mental errors. So I was taught as an order clerk on the floor, never trade an error. Never trade an error. If it's an error, you're supposed to be out, get out. If it's an error and you you put too much on accidentally, or you didn't mean, or you didn't mean to do the trade, just liquidate it right away. Do not play an error. Everyone give me an everyone give me an amen on that. Do not trade in error. Do not trade in error. Goldie's got a scalp here. I want to hear some amens in here from Coach Pinkert. Never trade in error. Nice look, Goldie. Right against a nice channel line. Thank you, Goldie. You know how I know? I've tried it. I've tried it. Don't do it. Who's tried it? If you're lucky, it worked out, but most of the time it doesn't. I learned that as an order clerk. You liquidate an error right away. Right away. Watch, Rob should be here fairly soon. Waiting for my buddy Ashraf Laidi. Another great mentor, coach, analyst, trader, Ashraf Laidi. Everyone thank Mauricio for arranging this interview with Ashraf. Unless Ashraf requested to come back. Maybe he wanted to come back. Sometimes people I interview, they want to come back time and time again. They'll get in touch with us saying, hey, find a day for me to have an interview. Vicky Schmelzer, Lada, Faith, Lydia. Very few people that have been interviewed in LAR do not want to come back. Very few. Just something I want to share with you guys. I got an email from Scott Carney yesterday, and I was pretty surprised. Scott Carney, you know, he has trademarks on the harmonics that he labeled and his rule-based stuff. And he informed me that Jason Stapleton and his company Trade Empowered, he's involved with litigation for plagiarizing Scott's work. So I interviewed Jason once and a couple other guys from Trade Empowered. Akil Stokes, I believe, is with him. And I have to go with Scott on this one. I'm not going to support and give visibility to people that plagiarize and steal other people's work. And I'm in Scott's corner on this one. So just want to let you know that when there are claims about who's the father or pioneer of harmonics, it's Scott Carney, not Jason Stapleton. Just wanted to make you guys aware of it. If you want to learn harmonics, learn it from the guy who went through all the effort of creating all these different harmonic patterns, labeling them, having the rules based for them, instead of someone who just assumed it. Okay. Well, it's a free world. You can do what you want. This is just information that you could use or delete. It's up to you. Thank you, Goldie. Ashraf, Mauricio has sent Ashraf the link, so I'm sure he's going to be with us shortly. Yeah, it was pretty oversold, wasn't it, Jake? And they're unwinding the euro pound. There you go. That's a good reason. When's the referendum? Not till June, is it? Maybe it rallies into the vote and that's it. Although I think a lot of people are still looking for 135 to be tested in the monthly lows in the pound down here. June 23rd. Okay, so we have a bit of a reversal month happening here, but a lot of people are still looking for the 08 lows. Good point. So is that taking the euro pound back down? Still thought we'd get a rally in euro pound. We'll see. So Lars bet, as there never was an exit, there will be no Brexit. There is no Brexit, no Brexit. Okay. Okay, see you, Midas. Glad you're hanging with us again, buddy. Cheers. Yeah, it'll do what it wants to do. It does. You got gas. You gas. Stand by for Ashraf. Everyone doing all right? Ashraf Laidi on the way. I think he's out of New York now, Ashraf. Stick around. So you want to be a star? You gotta show your charts and lar. Drive a jalopy, but you want a new car. Hang with us in lar. Rent a studio apartment, but you want a big house. You should be with us before you click your mouse. Give me an L. A. R. Lar. The Lara theme song. The Lara theme song, everybody. Give me a why if you love it. Good one, Dion. Story of the day. What's that? That's I know it makes you cry. I know. I made you cry twice today. Interesting. I like it. It's like the only thing the dollar's up against is the Canadian. Good one. Oh. Should be here already. FX Kennedy, welcome to LAR. Usually we start about 5 minutes ago. Okay, here he comes. I'll show that in a bit, Jay.
Hello.
Hi, Ashraf. How are you, buddy?
Hi, how are you, Dale? Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you. I see ArcSoft, Magic Eye, Visual Effects. Thank you so much for joining us again today, Ashraf. You're one of my favorite guests.
That's what you tell everyone.
Yeah, you have. No, I don't tell that to everyone. You know, I really don't. You're unique. You have that combination of being a great analyst, great trader, insightful, and a good sense of humor. So, you know, my view is that at times people take life and trading and everything else a bit too seriously. And although money is serious, it's not everything.
And thanks for... thanks for all that you're doing too, for the little and for the not so little guy out there.
Okay, buddy. So I got a message from my producer Mauricio Carrillo that with the NFP tomorrow, you're very focused on the hourly earnings. You think that's going to be the bullet point of the report? Can you expound on that?
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because, well, first of all, this is important. Let's just show the viewers. Can you see my screen?
I don't see a screen. I see ArcSoft Magic-I Visual Effects.
Okay. Sorry about that. Let me
see your picture up there in another box, but no charts yet, partner.
Oh. Okay. Let me.
So where you have to stop the screen share for a minute and then go to the desktop you want to show.
Yeah.
It's that green box. Green box with a white arrow, upper left-hand corner.
Yeah. Let's do this. Okay.
We're in Let's see, I just need to get mine out of there. So we want to show Ashraf's. So now we got it, buddy. So it looks like we have, there's a few things. Okay, now I see your desktop. I see everything, your Bloomberg. You did have a chart up there, but that disappeared with your
screen. All right, now you see the calendar.
I do.
And the sound is good.
Sound is clean.
Very good. Okay, so, well, before we speak about the average hourly earnings and unemployment, just say that this was a sort of a disappointing ISM figure here, ISM report. Not very bad, but the ISM it was still well above 51 and 52. But the prices paid index went to the lowest level since 2009.
Wow.
And the employment, which is important, the employment index in the services index went to the lowest level since in 2014. Now, so that's interesting because what happened, the Federal Reserve, it has a dashboard, it has a jobs dashboard, and it's been focusing on that, and the jobs have been growing very well. Then they cooled off a little bit, but what's really going to get them to change their mind and to want to raise rates, not change their mind, but to continue to raise rates, was a momentum following those CPI numbers and the core PCE. And the momentum comes in the wage pay, in the salary pay, and I think that we've seen some okay figures. So I think that if they do disappoint, I think it will really change the course of the story, because right now, the Federal Reserve, as it is right now, despite the recent improvement in data in the U.S., the situation is still, is still quite questionable, with oil and companies coming down and spreads, bond spreads pushing higher, and earnings is pretty much, negative, or, earnings growth. So here is the thing that I'm looking at right now. So,
the market, with the huge relief rally we've had in the market, it's been based upon that the Fed is done for a while. I mean, all the gauges are saying they may not even move until next year. So the market's expecting a pretty good report, right? Where it's, that's the thing the Fed is hanging their hat on, is employment. Employment has been the only thing really going their way. You point out what's happening in manufacturing. A lot of people are already saying we're in a manufacturing recession.
Yeah.
You point out prices are still not increasing. They continue to be quite soft. So tomorrow is an important NFP number based upon the Fed hanging their hat on one of the only measurements that they're looking at that's showing strength, being employment and wage growth.
Right. Not too hot, not too cold. But let me interrupt this broadcast. Let me interrupt this broadcast to say that look at gold.
Yeah.
Look at gold.
Okay.
Actually, let me interrupt myself. I like to do that. I don't let anybody do that, but I like to do that myself. because we need to look at the gold chart, and then I'll go back to speak about those things.
Okay.
Less important in the immediate term. Gold is very big move here. Obviously, everybody's looking at this chart. I promise you guys, we're going to go and speak about much sexier things like jobs.
I think gold is sexy.
I know. I was being sarcastic, yeah.
Okay. So, I mean, every bullion has its day, and definitely... Yeah. You can't argue with the price action, can you?
Yeah, you can't. I mean, look at this. Well, the thing is that, look, if you're a skeptical person, you would say, what is going to stop us that we didn't do here? We failed here. And now we're pushing higher. The good thing about this is that this consolidation here is doing well. And so it's a flag. You can call it a bullish flag, a pennant, whatever language you want to use. But if you go to the monthly chart, this baby, this one, I have other indicators that I look at that led me to further go in long gold, and that's related to a formula that I have between the gold bugs index and gold. It's a special formula that I have. But right now, this thing is telling us this thing is going up. And again, you need to be skeptical. You have to be skeptical. You got to question yourself. So once again, oh, wow, this is the monthly chart. The 55 moving average is coming down, is rolling over. That is true. What are we seeing here? We're testing the 100-month moving average. Why would we have to break it? Well, look at the channel. You have to be skeptical. You got to think not in terms of your portfolio. You got to think with logic. Not because you put money into something, then you let your mind just think that way, you know? So, so basically, you know, when Trump asked Bush was like barely alive, Bush Jeb, and he said, "All right, had you known that there was had you known that there were no WMDs, would you have still gone in?" And Bush thinks, "My brother before logic," and he goes, "Yeah, I would still have gone in." And Bush, who was already sinking in the polls, said that, and he just dived 6 feet under. Never mind. So, if you're looking at the market here, for those of you who do not see the reason and rhyme why I integrated that with this, never mind. But if you basically, you know, just because you're long gold, don't try to always say, "Well, the chart is going to go my way because I have predetermined that I want to go in." Ask yourself, look at this channel. We failed. Why should we pass here? Why should we jump here? Well, look at these various levels of the momentum. Look at these various levels of the stochastics. Yeah. In the English language, we have done what you call a break. So we have broken here. These are actually my own stochastics. And so basically, you've got a high here and here and bingo. Okay, nice. We've broken this one.
Nice we look.
I'm sorry?
Nice look.
We're looking at this, and we did not break the momentum here. We didn't break it here. We broke it here. But still, the road is still high, still long. This is not over. We're not talking about $2,000 or $5,000 gold. Take it easy. Gold bullion, you know, gold is not the most liquid thing. It can smack you in the face just when you start to believe in it. It will smack you in the face. It does that. There is plenty of time and road and time on the calendar between this 1269 and between 1310. But
okay. What's a bit different this time, besides the technicals, is that before the recent rally that we've had here against the U.S. dollar, that gold was rallying in other currency terms, and now the dollar has finally joined the party, suffering or gold benefiting against the dollar, but the gold has been rallying against other currencies, global currencies, for well over a year or so, and now it's rallying against gold. So now it has almost a unanimous currency vote that people aren't trusting any paper, and they're buying gold.
Yeah, I mean that is true. You know, gold has started to stabilize. It has been easier for gold to do well against the non-dollar currencies because the non-dollar currencies have been weak against the U.S. dollar. So it's easy for the yellow metal to do well against the bad stuff, the weak stuff. It is easy to beat up on somebody that is weak. You want to know how good you are? Come and go and fight the U.S. dollar. So that's what the dollar... But you know what? Let me tell you something. No, I don't want to beat up on the dollar because the dollar has been having a bad 2 or 3 days. Why don't we beat up on the yen? So what I'm going to show you gold versus the yen. You want to go to the big time now. And this is what I said in my book. You got to look at the value of currencies. The best way to look at currencies, not against each other, but against gold. Okay?
Because what's the title of your book, Ashraf? What's the title of it?
It's Currency Trading and Intermarket Analysis. Okay. I mean, I'll show you the link here.
All right.
Look at this. Yeah, so basically, yeah, it's ashraflaidi.com, and you go / and you go to book. Basically here. Anyway, okay. So...
I want an autographed copy.
Okay, yeah, it's been a while since I haven't been to the U.S., so, you know, I need, mail that would be a good reason. Guys, look at this. Look at this. Appreciate the plug. Appreciate and backing me up on the plug. Look, this is dollar, this is gold versus the yen. All right? This is the tough yen. This is the yen. So as you can see, the momentum still have not been broken, okay? Because it's not hard, it's not easy to break above the momentum of the yen because the yen is strong. This is gold, all right? It's still. However, look at that trend line. Look at the red trend line. I promise you, I'm going to speak this 2 more minutes back about employment.
Okay. No, this is important. This is important. I agree with you because this hasn't happened in a long time.
Yeah, this is a big deal. This is a big deal. And maybe not, I don't know, some people have gold versus the yen. When I wrote my book, I didn't have these charts. I had to do it in Excel. But, you know, but this is better. You know, now we're older and wiser. We've got a little bit more money, so we can do these charts. And it's, you know, it helps me. It helps everyone. So basically, if you remove, if you ignore the trend line, then you're really talking about, some people could call it a pyramid. You know, you're talking about this, you're talking about that. You're talking about the trend line will be extended here. Then you're talking about above this level. So we're talking about, but you know, if later on we start talking about probably 1260, 1275, 1285. Now, I want to take 2 minutes to speak about the fundamentals of gold, because the problem with fundamentals, it can always sound good. You can always make a story to sell your story. But the technicals is the one that differentiates this from that. So it differentiates. That is the one that highlights your case in a more unique sense. And I believe I did that in the momentum trend line in the stochastics for gold versus the dollar. Fundamentally speaking, here is the thing. Yes, the Federal Reserve is the only one in town that is thinking or talking or considering raising rates. But here is the thing. What is different this time, we have a very uniquely positive combination for gold, and I'll say this very slowly, a uniquely positive combination for gold. There's many reasons, but I'll tell you what. You know what it is, Dale? In 2010 and 2011, when QE was a novelty, it was a new thing, all right? It was a new thing. People were like, oh my God, we are shocked, oh wow. There is going to be QE. They are going to throw money at the system. Gold goes up. But then they did QE1, QE2, Operation Twist, QE3, and the market became desensitized from gold, and they realized that gold...
Let me guess. I'm interrupting you. Negative interest rates is the big deal.
No, it's no. I'm not that predictable. So one of them,
it really did light a fuse on gold when BOJ did that.
I actually disagree. When the ECB they cut interest rates, gold did not really move that much. When the BOJ did that, gold did not move right away. But it is moving. But I do agree with you. Negative interest rates. The idea of negative interest rates will help gold, but there is something else, and that something else is that, you see, negative interest rates is not by itself. Why? Because if negative interest rates is going to remain the case, and inflation is going to remain below zero, let's say inflation did not improve, core PCE price index, the one that the Fed watches, did not go to 1.7. Let's say it goes to 1.1. The main reason that gold went down over the last few years was disinflation, because inflation went down.
Okay.
What we are seeing right now is a little bit more subtle. And what is subtle is that you will have negative interest rates, and you will not necessarily have deflation. You will have inflation rising, but not enough to stop the presses, not enough to get the hawks panicking. It will be just enough inflation, just enough positive for the gold bugs to start re-embracing their religion. Okay? Gold religion. Because
A stagflation environment.
You can say stagflation, exactly. You can say stagflation. For those who don't know what stagflation is rising inflation, but low employment, high unemployment, subtrend growth. The only difference that I have with stagflation is because stagflation would be very high inflation or high inflation. I don't think we're going to be seeing necessarily high inflation, but I hope you've seen the point. Now, that's the fundamental explanation. And you and me and him and her and she and it can discuss about, well, what's enough, what's not enough, what's too high. So that's why I don't want to argue too much about that.
Okay.
The technicals that I've shown is part of the technicals that I'm going to share with my clients in my premium clients. But the other ones I will share later on.
I will push back a little bit on negative interest rates, because the bears' argument against gold for many years and decades was opportunity cost, because there was no yield on it.
Absolutely.
With negative interest rates, all of a sudden, gold has no opportunity costs, because there isn't competition.
And I totally agree with that. I totally agree with that. Those are one of the first reasons that I always told people, look, they're going to cut interest rates. They're running out of the bullets. And gold has to go up. However, that notion took a break. Why? Because even though they were cutting interest rates low, 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 the substitution effect was supposed to be good for gold, okay? Inflation was low, and it was deflation. And we had never seen negative inflation in the UK, we have never seen -0.2 inflation in the Eurozone. When we start seeing that, gold went down, and all the gold bugs started to scratch their head. But what's going on? Interest rates are low. They're running out of bullets. Why is inflation not gold? Why gold not up? That's why it's important to mention these things. It's very important to go into the heart of the matter and say why this is different than then. This is very important. That's what we do here. We trade the stuff. We talk about it in details. We don't waffle. We don't buffle. Okay. So if you want to talk to me about gold, I'll take you to the jungle, to the sea, to the airplane, anywhere, and I'll talk to you about gold or about anything you want. But you
okay. Then let me ask you one more question. When I was a young guy, about 100 years ago. Yeah. And I started off in the business. one of the celebrities of the business was a guy called Larry Williams, how he turned 10,000 into a million. Yes. And what I learned from Larry was he said stock market rallies were okay, but when gold is rallying with it, that there was something inherently wrong with the equities, because gold is like a thermometer. The higher it goes, the higher the temperature the patient has. So any views on this recovery with S&Ps, and based upon what Larry Williams said, gold definitely is not only rallying with the S&Ps, but outperforming and leading it.
Sure. A lot of people who may think that I am a chronically, structurally, ideologically bearish, are wrong, because we've actually given a trade on long the DAX, and we went long the DAX, we got out, we made money, and now we are short something else. Now, here is the trades. I'm going to answer your question, but before I answer the question, I'm going to go through it through basically, so there's
I don't know why people think that about you, Ashraf, because I follow your tweets and your work. You're a lot like me. You know, we may be cynical and jaded, but we're not perma bears or perma bulls.
Yeah.
We take the messages of the market and try and capitalize on it.
Yeah. Well, look, this is a chart that I've shown in December webinar, and I've shown to my clients time and time again. If you are standing, make sure you're sitting, and if you're sitting, make sure you're not holding any coffee or anything hot, because the weekly chart of the S&P 500 shows as follows. The S&P, this is the S&P chart, this is the weekly chart, that's where we are, a nice rally.
Yeah.
And what we're doing here is very similar to what we did in 2007. And I've pointed this out. This is what people are wondering on Twitter. What's this thing you talk about, the 05-08 parallel? 05-08 parallel to me is the May 2008 parallel, which is basically shows that October, November of last year was very similar to May 08. We had a temporary rally. Now we are in June 08. What am I talking about? What are you talking about, Ashraf? I'll tell you what I'm talking
okay,
about.
Okay, so you're using that fractal.
Yeah, it's a fractal. Call it a fractor. Call it whatever you want to call it.
Okay.
Yeah. So here's the thing. Yeah. Yeah. So you want to be fancy, let's get fancy. Yeah, you want to use, okay. Be careful. Ed Matz may sue you. Ed Matz, whenever you use the F word, he's going to go after you. Okay. So, all right.
I love you, man.
So all basically, right, the high in 07, we had the high, we broke below the 55 week moving average, we broke below, we stabilized the 100, we failed the trend line, fell below the 100, fell below it, stabilized the 200, went back up, respected the trend line, failed the 55, and bang. Really?
Nice.
Okay. So yeah. What are we doing now?
We tried to do this in 2011. Like Vincente Fox and Donald Trump says, you know, they're all using the F word in politics now.
Yeah, well,
I'm guessing that there's, let's use similarities instead of F. How about
parallels,
that?
Parallels.
I love that. Yeah, parallels. Okay.
So basically, so in 2011 we tried to do that, but we broke above the trend line. Why? I'll tell you why 2011 was not quite, and I was saying this back in October, that this is not going to be 2011, and I'll tell you why in a minute. But let's look at now, and here is the story. You do the high, you break below the 55, you break below the 100, you stabilize well above the 200, you break below 100. This time you do break above the 55, and you fail, and you come down. But what's different? Unlike 11, the 55-week moving average is humping down. It's turning down, so that's very different. It's turning down towards the 100. Now,
okay.
Long story short, here's what I said, and I'll tell you what I said here. You don't need to take my word for it. You just need to see, to look at the evidence. And I actually gave this not to my clients, but I gave this to my free subscribe, you know, those who are members of the newsletter and who go to the website are not necessarily, they're not paying subscribers. I put it on the free website. And what am I talking about? I'll tell you what I'm talking about.
Well, you know what? I nominate Ashraf Laidi for the Nobel Peace Prize for humanitarianism.
Thank you. Okay. Now we're talking. Okay. So watch this. So February 11th. This is very important. China's FX reality. Where are we? Hold on a second. Be patient. February 9th. Do you believe in Yellen? No, I don't believe in Yellen. The central bank playbook from here. Watch, because I'm going to show you something that... hold on. Okay, yeah, this one here.
Okay.
Just
that was when we cleaned out the stops under 1810 and the S&P.
Here, guys. All right, so February 17th. So in case somebody wonders, so Adam Button writes these things here, and I put the charts. So when the stock market was in 1926, when the S&P was in 1926, I don't usually do this sort of stuff. It may seem like, you know, highly predictive or highly, you know, casino. But I said we're going to go all the way up to 2015, maybe 2020, come down hard, stabilize, and then come down, okay?
Okay, 1620. When is St. Patrick's Day? Because I know the equinox is the 21st or 23rd. When's St. Patty's Day? So I could paint myself green.
I think it's, I don't know, the 15th, the 16th, the 17th, okay. Something like
right.
that.
Right.
I'm glad you asked that question, Mr. Pinkert, because May 15th, March 15th, it's the Ides of March, you know, the okay. Ides of March.
Right, yes. A2, Ashraf.
Sorry?
A2, Ashraf.
A2, yeah.
Instead of A2, Brutus.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
So, look, A2, yeah, exactly. Look, March 16th is the Federal Reserve. March 15th is the Fed Day. The decision of the Fed is 16th, okay? The Chancellor of the Exchequer, the UK Chancellor, is going to release his budget on the 16th or the 15th. You have many other events, very, very big. There's a lot of speeches. We have the jobs numbers from the UK. When we were in 1920, we said we're going to go up, up. A lot of people said we don't have legs. Well, here is what the S&P is doing. We are in 1980. I think we're going to go here. We're going to go to our 1980. We're going to break below. We're going to test the 100-week moving average. And we're going to go in between the 55 and the 100. And I think that's where we're going to fail. And where are we going to stop? 220, 230? I'm not sure. It's going to be very tough. I cannot predict in accuracy.
That was an excellent call.
In the Dow, the equivalent of the Dow is 17,200, I believe. It's going to be 17,200. All right? In the DAX, I think we are almost there. That's why we actually, when we took profit and we bought the DAX here, we tried to play it safe. We went here. We bought 95.20. We targeted 99.80. We didn't have the guts to wait, so we got out at 97.70. Okay. Where is the DAX doing now? The DAX is 97.40, so it's there. But we are shorting the FTSE. Okay. This stuff is pretty subtle. You have to be very subtle with these things. But anyway. So, Mr. Pinkert, the story with the stocks, it's very tough when you're able to trade if you are bearish and you try to show off by trying to show how detailed you are on the corrective upside, that's very difficult, because especially if you have followers, if you give them a signal out there, because you don't know what leverage people are using. If you're doing it for yourself, that's fine. If you're trading yourself and you are bearish but you want to trade the bounce, that's fine. But I got a lot of people who say, Ashraf, what's going on? You got a 200 pip stop. I can't handle it. Well, you know, I'm sorry, mate. You know,
why don't you just tell them to reduce leverage?
Absolutely. So I tell them, do two things. You reduce leverage, you reduce the size, or you have various positions, very small positions. Because you know what, Dale? I've got some people who complain and they say, why do you keep on getting out of positions? I said, I've just made 258 pips in Aussie yen. Why? He said, well, because my model, I put the system on your thing and I have to adjust. I said, tough luck, my friend. I said, you're only paying $90 a month and you're complaining. I give you the technicals, the fundamentals, the charts, and I give you 258, and you're going to complain to me that I get out 30 pips early and I do not deliver the promised 330 pip and I get out at 258 and you're complaining? It's incredible. There are some
Ashraf, I understand that. This is what I would say to these people. A lot of people would be happy just to get back to even on their accounts. And I say to people is this, and you know, one of my shortcomings is getting out before targets. But you know what? I'm still making money. And here's my Pinkertism. Don't expect perfection at the craps table.
Absolutely, absolutely, absolutely. And I know these people are clients and everything, and there's only so much you can pander to clients, listen to the clients, but you have to put your foot down when it's warranted. Anyway, all right, so basically this is a story. Dolly Yen was still short. You remember in December?
Yeah.
In December we said our favorite trade is going to be Sterling Aussie. Sterling Aussie just fell around 800 pips or 700 pips. Going back to the job report, I think that pretty much the market is saying that, yes, there is not going to be a rate hike in March, but that's not the first time that the market is at odds with the Fed. I think the Feds want to take a break from that. It will be very bad. It will be very bad news for the Fed if the job market is going to surprise on the upside. But to me, what I say is that as long as average hourly earnings, basically, and there's two of them. There is the year-on-year, and there's the month-on-month. And what you need to watch out is basically the average hourly earnings. And by the way, there's no Canada job report tomorrow. There's no Canada. So it's all U.S. Average hourly earnings. So basically, this is expected to slow from 0.5 to 0.2. So if it does that, that's not going to be good news. But the year-on-year is expected to remain unchanged at 2.5. And that's not hard because year-on-year, you're comparing it to far back. So it's not hard to have a higher number. So that's something really to watch out for. The hours and the labor participation is important. So these are quite important, but I think that there's a notion that I would like to speak about, which is the following. If we are going to be long gold or favorable gold or bullish gold, then what do you do with the dollar? Does that mean you're bearish dollar? And it's
I'm glad you're going there, okay, because when I look at the Dixie chart, that double top above 100, whether or not we pull back first, which I think we can do, to me it looks like it has destiny to clean out the dollar bears over par and a half. Yeah. And in tying it into gold, I'm thinking that that's what creates the pullback from higher levels in gold, is one more hurrah on the dollar above the Dixie 100 level.
So makes sense. Makes sense. Look, this is the chart that I posted again to the free guys, the non-paid guys, on February 19th. This chart right here. So basically, this is the Dixie. You know, Win Dixie. You remember that stuff?
Okay. Yes.
All right. Okay. So basically, you've got a down channel and an up channel. This is, again, February 17th, folks, February 17th. For those of you who have put this on mute, tough luck. Okay, so February 17th, you got a diamond. We broke this into diamond. We broke into diamond 2. We rested 2, and then we said, where are we going to go? Are we going to go to 3A or 3B or this one, 3C? And we anticipated that we're going to go to the top of the range. So that's where we are now. Here's where we are. Here's where we are. 1, 2, 3. Here's where we are. Here's where we are, and here's where we are. We are in the top of that diamond. Girl's best friend. All right. So we were here. We were here. We recovered here. I do not think the dollar is going to break above this diamond here. I don't think it's going to get out. I think we may push higher. However, if you say that stocks go up while the dollar go up, and if you say that stocks are expected to go further up and to correct higher, then don't you think that the dollar is going to push higher? Yes, Your
right,
Honor.
Right. That's exactly what I was going to ask you.
So, yes, Your Honor. Yes, I will not need my lawyer to speak. Let me speak. Okay, lawyer, give yourself a bathroom break. So, basically, I think the dollar could push higher, and it could fail around 99, 100. I don't know. What may bring this up? Maybe a big upside in the job report? I don't know. Maybe what? Something else. Maybe things will be bad for the Fed, but maybe the European Central Bank on March the 10th will do something, right? So we don't want to speculate on fundamentals too much. Let's talk about the chart. And the chart is telling me that this could push higher. It could play around 99, 98, and then it could come down. And then when it comes down, we don't know. Either it's going to stay into a new diamond here, all right, or it's going to, again, so just for you to look at the situation here, because a lot of people need to appreciate. Okay, just give me a second. So this is how it looks. This is how this looks, okay? And, okay, so basically, I think that we probably come down. Hold on a second, I'm having some alerts on my phone. Some things are moving. Just give me a second, guys. I just need to do some. It's to do with the trade.
Energy is exploding. Crude's exploding.
Hold on, guys. Yeah, I've just got a few accounts here that I'm trading, and hold on. Boy, oh boy, oh boy. All right, man, oh man. As David Letterman would say, man alive. Okay, 0.7. Okay, all right, 0.7. Okay, just give me a second. Sorry, guys. I've got some important business to attend. I've got to close some positions here. You know, you have to realize some gains while they're happening, and then you go back in. Hold on a second. Sorry, guys. I had some long Aussie and long Kiwi trades. Okay, just give me a second, please. Okay, so yeah. All right, guys. All right, so basically the way I look at it is that, okay, this is the important, the fundamental explanation about gold, about the dollar. Dale, okay, here's the situation. When the dollar in 2007, 2008, I'm going to move the mic here. When the Fed started to raise rates in 04, 05, and 06, it was the first central bank that started to raise central bank, while the rest were tired and sick and tired. But what does that mean? What does that mean? That also means, ladies and gentlemen, that it was first in, first out, FIFO. What does that mean? What does FIFO mean? Because the Fed was the first one to go in to raise rates, but it was the first one to get out. The Federal Reserve stopped raising rates in June 2006, right?
Yeah.
When it stopped raising rates in 06, everybody else was still raising. BOE, ECB, RBA, NZD, RBNZ, they all started to raise up into 2008. When the Federal Reserve was the first one that stopped raising rates, that means that was bad for the dollar. That's why the dollar was falling across the board in 06, 07, and part of 08. Are you following me?
Yes.
All right. The dollar was the first one to, the Federal Reserve was truly leading on the rate hike, and then it led on the pause, and then it led in QE. Well, the BOE did it, the BOJ did it, the ECB was last. When the Fed was leading in QE in March 09, it really started in December 08, the dollar was the first one to take the big hit. And that's why when the bottom, March 09, 666 on the S&P, everything started to go up against the dollar, because the United States Central Bank was the one that was leading in cutting rates.
QE. Dollar broke 30%, S&P's rallied 30%. He had nominal gains.
Right. QE. The Federal Reserve was the central bank that was leading in terms of QE. So one way of looking at it is the one who was leading in cutting interest rates into a negative. QE was zero interest rate, ZERP, and the Fed was the one that was leading. That's why the dollar was the one that was taking a hit. Now here's what happened. That's why 09, 010, 11, 12, 13, the dollar was the classic funding carry trade currency. And that's why, ladies and gentlemen, when the stock market would go up, the dollar would go down. All right? It was the carry trade. It was the funding currency. Interest rates were low for a long time, and the Fed was the one that took us there. And then the ECB joined, and then everybody else joined. Now, what's going on now? Now, the Federal Reserve wants to be the first one. Now, we got to be careful. We got to listen to me very carefully. The Federal Reserve is the first one that wants to lead in raising rates. And that's why we're seeing what we're seeing. The dollar pushes up When there is good stuff in the world economy and stocks, the dollar goes up because it is expected to be the central bank, not only the first central bank that led us towards rate hike, but it could lead us towards further rate hike. And that's why the dollar is gaining. What does that mean? Drum roll. What does that mean?
Eventually, other central banks are going to have to tighten with the Fed if they continue.
Aha! Either that or...
Or the Fed does a trichet.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Or the Fed is going to be the first one to go into the fetal position.
Yeah. Okay.
If the Fed is going to be the first one, well, not the first one, the only one, because everybody else is already in fetal position.
Yes.
For those of you who are not English or American and don't know what the word fetal, it's the first one that is going to go into a defensive position. It's the first one that is going to come down from its pedestal of higher rates. It's so when it's going to come down and join the rest, when it's going to come down from its Ivy League and join the other stinking currency, people are going to beat up on it because it is the one that is falling hard because it has more downside. The other guys do not have downside. And that's what the currency market does. It does not trade in absolute terms.
Reversion to the mean,
buddy? In relative terms. There is more downside for the dollar, so that's why I'm going to sell. So that's it's what either notion that you mentioned, Dale, which is the first one to continue to raise, or the first one to cut. And when that happens, gold is going to say, okay, baby, I'll take it from here.
Ashraf, another excellent interview. Speaking about fetal positions, your work is the umbilical cord for people to stay on top of important markets. And speaking of diamonds, Ashraf, you keep talking about diamonds in the Dixie. I say this, that when you listen or see Ashraf, he's as brilliant as a diamond. You better put on your shades. Thanks for another great, revealing, insightful interview. My trading warrior,
my pleasure,
brother.
Dale. Thank you very much for what you're doing.
Shala, shalom, l'chaim, buddy.
Thanks, man. Wishing you better health and keep doing what you're doing as long as you like what you're doing. All right?
All right, all partner. Fun. Yeah. Breathing in and out, and my mission is to lift up others, and I know that we share this as kindred spirits to lift up others. Thank you for all the great work you do, and thanks for coming back to Lard Edify, my community.
Thanks, Dale. Thanks, FX Street. Thanks, everyone. Good luck, everyone, tomorrow, and after tomorrow, and after tomorrow. Take care,
guys. All
right,
buddy.
Take care.
Thank you, Ashraf. Everyone, thank Ashraf Laidi for another great presentation in the live analysis room. You're not going to see better live analysis. And as I said, Ashraf, insightful. I see some comments that you enjoy Ashraf's sense of humor. And I have to wrap it up here. No wrap up for me today. I'll see everyone tomorrow for the NFP an hour early with Adam Button, Yohei Elam, Valeria Bednarik, and the one and only Mauricio Carrillo. Good hunting, everybody. See everyone tomorrow, and stick around for Kathy. Kathy Lean is up. She's on deck. And when I get a base hit, there's no one better to come on and bring me around the bases than Kathy Lean. So stick around for Kathy and see everyone tomorrow. Adios.